thank you all for coming. Here we go. Let's see how it goes. Steve, you're up first.
Okay.
If you don't mind introducing yourself before you get started. And I'm going to start your timer.
All right, I'm Steve Willard, and I grew up at number 80 Front Street here in Marblehead. It's directly across the street from the Landing Restaurant. So I grew up there on the waterfront, in the boatyards. And what I'd like to do is give you a little bit of a story about that area, and then I'm going to tell of an incident that happened at a place called Salty Sam's Restaurant. How many of you remember Salty Sam's Restaurant?
Salty Sam's.
In Marblehead. It's where the current Landing Restaurant is now. And Salty Sam's was a small, single-story tin shack that ran pretty much on the same footprint that the current restaurant is on. The front of it was Salty Sam's. There was a mannequin on the ridge outside in the front on Front Street with yellow oilskins on and holding an oar like this. That was Salty Sam. Well, Salty Sam's restaurant, when I was young, was run by a fellow named Porky Parmer. Anybody remember Porky Parmer? His son, Buzzy Parmer, was our police chief. Well, Porky was kind of a character. But one day, the environmental police boat from Boston, which was called the Lula May, came into State Street Wharf and tied up. Well, the skipper on Lula May was Bud Frost from Marblehead. Bud had a young rookie aboard, and he came up to Salty Sam's and he asked Porky, he said, "What do you have today that's good?" And George Berry, a local fisherman, had been gill netting that day. He caught a big gray shark. So he cut a big bunch of slabs off of that gray shark. He gave a few pieces to Porky. So Porky says to this young rookie, he says, "I've got some great swordfish right off the boat." And the kid says, "I love it, I'll have some." And Porky put a slab of it on the grill and put some lettuce and tomatoes and a few french fries and took it out and served it to this kid. And the kid ate that, you know, with relish. And Porky came over and said, "How did you enjoy your meal?" And the kid said, "That was the best damn swordfish I ever ate." Porky said, "Well, I'm glad you thought so, because," he said, "you just ate a piece of gray shark." Well, this kid went ballistic, and he threatened to sue Porky. He was going to close him down, and he was going to do all kinds of different violations. And just about then, Bud Frost walked in the door. And he says, "You're not going to do a damn thing, but keep your mouth shut and get back down to the boat. This man was just having fun with you. He wasn't even going to charge you for the meal." And that was the end of that story with Porky Parmer. One other quick thing, and I think I've talked to this with Jack, and I mentioned it to Porky's son, Buzzy. Porky had some placemats made up one time, and I'm hoping I can find one someday. So far, no luck. But there's a storm drain that runs down between the wharves there. And Porky had placemats made up that said, "Salty Sam's Restaurant, where the sewer meets the sea." I can't make that up. I need to find one of those placemats. So somebody find one for me. So, what I'd like to do today is talk about the boatyard at number 89 Front Street, the old James E. Graves yard. There were two James E. Graves boatyards in Marblehead. One is at Beacon Street. They're currently called Marblehead Trading Company. But what I want to talk about is the art of hauling and moving boats around these yards. Many years ago, before fiberglass boats, every boat in these yards was wood. And each boat had its own wooden cradle built specifically for that boat. Now, there was a big marine railway at Front Street. There were two railways at Beacon Street. And these railways ran on carriages on railroad tracks. And they would be lowered down. We'd put a cradle on the railway, whichever cradle, whatever boat we're trying to haul that day, chain it down, because of course they were wood, they would float. So it had to be chained down to the railway, and the railway was ballasted so that the whole thing wouldn't just float up. To do this took a fair amount of skill, because the boat had to be brought in and driven into that cradle, and then they'll take up some slack until the boat grounded out. And once that happened, you had to get that boat perfectly plumb. If it was leaning one way or the other, lot of weight leaning on the bilge arms of that cradle. So if it was perfectly plumb, the weight was all bearing straight down. And that was controlled through wedges that would be driven into the what they call the bilge arms that supported the boat. And once that was done, that railway would be brought up until it was level with the ground and the rest of the boat yard. So the entire yard, both up down at Front Street and the one at Beacon Street, had a grid system of wood buried in the ground. And that system would allow those boats in those wooden cradles to be pulled into place, into storage, into the sheds. We had dead men all over the boatyard. Now, who knows what a dead man is? Anybody?
It's normally a big chain tied to something very solid in the ground, which won't move.
Right.
Now, I don't know if you dare mention what they use to haul a rope with.
The big winches.
Yeah. What the bell-shaped thing was called.
Well, no, we won't go there. They were winches. Winch heads. What we had these big electric winches that were vertically mounted. And what we would do, this is where the art came in.
Gotcha.
This little trinket here.
Oh my God.
We would, some of these boats, back here, the microphone. Some of these boats were 60 to 80 feet long. So you're talking about a substantial amount of weight. Plus, four of these triple shiv blocks and hundreds of feet of 1¼-inch line. These blocks would be fastened, two to the cradle of the boat and two to the dead man on the other end of the yard. And then the line would be woven through the shivs of these blocks. The more parts of line that you had, the more shivs, the bigger mechanical advantage you had to move these boats around the boatyard. We used to take and put tallow on these wooden grid systems. And that tallow would help the boats move as we pulled on them with the winch. Now I've seen, we had what they called dogs, which is a big U-shaped casting that clamped down over the runners of the cradles, one on each side. And we could steer the boat by adjusting these dogs from side to side. And then we could take and guide that line and that boat anywhere we wanted it in the yard. But the amount of force required to move a boat of 80 foot in this big wooden cradle was substantial. I have seen four of these blocks with all the hundreds of feet of line. I have seen a piece of half-inch chain break from the strain that we put on it with these big electric winches. And the whole assembly, hundreds and hundreds of pounds, right across the yard. And if you had happened to be standing in the way, it would have cut you right in half. Very dangerous, very dangerous. But there again, it was an art form, moving these boats.
About what year are you talking about?
Back in the 50s and 60s. Now, of course, the boatyards are all paved over, and they have hydraulic trailers and big cranes. So now at Beacon Street, they have this brand new huge crane that can pick up an 80-foot boat easily, drop it onto a hydraulic trailer, and then that boat can be driven anywhere in the yard and just put on jack stands. Not like the old days where each boat had its own wooden cradle. So
it is amazing that it still works off the same principle of the crane still works off the same principle of the gears of the boats.
Yeah, the crane has, I don't know, four shiv blocks, probably four or five shivs. So you're talking a lot of parts. And one of the favorite things that I like to do with the kids, I give a talk every year to the eighth grade classes. They come around and Betty and I talk to the kids about the history of Marblehead. But what I'd like to do is get a couple of strong volunteers to hold on to these two blocks. And then, hold on to that now, real tight. Okay, you got it?
I got it.
But anyway.
Little 3-in-1 oil.
Yeah. The kids like to do that. So, there was an awful lot of activity on the waterfront in Marblehead. Between Tucker's Wharf, which was the Marblehead Transportation Company, and then, of course, the old Boston Yacht Club, which was on pilings out in front of where State Street Wharf is now. Then you had the Marblehead Rental Boat Company, which ran out of the float there, the training company. Odie Millmore was the one that ran the Marblehead Rental Boat Company. Odie was the son-in-law of James E. Graves, who married to Barbara Graves. And we used to give sailing lessons and run launches. We had a launch service. We had two launches, the Cabby 1, the Cabby 2. And that was a very busy area. We had a contract at one point with Endicott College, which was an all-girls school at the time. We had 400 girls signed up for sailing lessons. So it was a pretty good thing for us young single guys. Until one day, the son of Ray Hunt, who was a very famous yacht designer, whose office was in the same building as Salty Sam's, his son Joshua decided that it was too foggy for sailing lessons. So let's have a party aboard Dad's boat. The end result of that party was 77 girls being expelled from Endicott College and the loss of their contract for sailing lessons. Mr. Millmore was not pleased. So, trying to think where to go next with this. But, any questions? Anybody get any questions? Bob?
Yeah, were you considered a wharf rat?
I was a wharf rat. I am a wharf rat.
Explain what that is.
I am still a wharf rat. Even though I live in Barnegat.
I was just going to say.
It's what you call a mixed marriage. I married a Barnegatter. Wharf rat was anybody who grew up on State Street Wharf was a wharf rat. If you grew up at Commercial Street, you were a shipyarder. And if you grew up at the lower yard, you were a Barnegatter. And you didn't mix. anyway, just trying to think where to go next. There's a lot of stories. One of the things that comes to mind is this beautiful painting right here. The title of that is Goodwin's Head. And Goodwin's Head, of course, is Goodwin's Court. And I just received a copy of this recently from a friend. And I didn't realize the significance until I looked at it. I said, Goodwin's Head. I said, well, my grandfather bought Goodwin's Head in the 1940s. He bought the three houses on the end, number 21, number 19, and number 17. He lived in number 19. He ran number 21 as a guest house, the Bayview guest house. And number 17 he tore down to create a garden, which he enjoyed very much for most of his life. He did eventually build a garage in that spot. And several years later, my brother was looking to purchase a house here in town. He couldn't buy a house. The prices were just out of hand. So my mother said, I will give you lot number 17, and you can build your house there, and that will be your inheritance. So we did that. We built a house in 1977, I think, for my brother, number 17. Marblehead Pottery. One thing leads into another. Marblehead Pottery was located in Goodwin's Court back in the 20s in a very small house. they had a small retail shop out on Front Street where the entrance is to the Leslie Cove condominium complex now. At one point, they outgrew their little house on Goodman's Court. And they actually, according to a letter that I found quite recently that I wasn't aware of, they bought number 21. I thought they just leased it, but they bought it. And they ran Marblehead Pottery out of 21 Goodman's Court.
Wow.
And so that is another story in itself. Very quickly, when the Leslie Hotel was torn down many years ago, a local contractor took two dump trucks full of Marblehead pottery to the landfill near Marblehead. Two dump trucks full.
Seriously? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Questions for Steve or a comment that you'd like to share that relates to what he was talking about? Just raise your hand, I'll come.
The yacht club that used to be down at the end of Goodwin's Court, is that building still there? Is
Yeah, that's number 21, which has recently been converted to a single family house.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess the one memory that came up, my mom worked at Barnegat Seafoods when I was in third grade, fourth grade, and I'd go down there every day after school, and it was right on the cusp of wood versus fiberglass, and there was still mostly wood. And the number of craftsmen that worked in the yards, I mean, I don't know the exact number, but at least 25 guys working through the yards, working on different things with their own specialty, and you know, the time and care that it took to go out boating with a wooden boat and no mechanical cranes and stuff like that was quite remarkable. So thanks for your
I remember the first fiberglass boat that came into the boat yard down there. And we all looked at it and laughed. We said, that crap will never catch on. We were wrong.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Wonderful. Great start. Thank you so much. Betty, are you good to go? Are you ready?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm always ready.
I know. Share a story. Come on up.
Can't give up, but I'm always ready. I come armed with photographs. One of the things that I remember about Marblehead, when I was growing up, we were a town of neighborhoods. So if you talk about something that happened in Barnegat, I don't know. Talk about something that happened at Shipyard, I'm right there. And we didn't mix in schools. So that the Glover School was Clifton, I was Rhodes School, then we had the Story School and the Gary School, and it was all separate. It's amazing. And then what kids wear to school today? My mother wouldn't have let me out the door. They don't dress that way. And I brought a couple of pictures. I'm not going to put them out here, but what kids wore to school when I was going to school were clothes. No pants, shorts that were, shall we say, mind-boggling. Nothing like that. One of the things that I find about photographs over the winter of a couple of years, Lauren and I have been going through photographs. Please identify the people in the photograph. I can usually tell where it was taken just because of the buildings, and I've lived here all my life. But if you don't know who they, you know, Fred Lichtman, we knew him because he was hand-boned to the core. He was everyone. But every once in a while, something would come out in a thing. I'm sure Don Dolliver knows all about this. This was printed in 1972. And it's Marblehead put together and photographed, and it's absolutely wonderful because you forget what Marblehead looked like in 1972. But they're all in here. And it's, most of them are identified, and it's accurate. Lauren and I are going to have to go through it because there are all this business about the things were brought from England. We had trees here. They didn't have trees in England. So, whatever. But this is kind of fun. Very interesting to look at. There's a shot in here that I particularly like because Marblehead was not dressy when I was growing up. Not at all. I was born in 1932. So I remember the end of the Depression, and the Marblehead Public School, Marblehead Library was in the selectman's room at Abbott Hall. So I would walk from West Cottage Street, where I grew up, down to Abbott Hall, and the shipyard was pretty awful.
Yeah.
It was run down terribly, as was the bottom of Washington Street, what they call the Five Corners. A lot of broken windows with pieces of cardboard in them. And the kids who would come to school, some of them didn't have central heat, and you'd get this awful smell of kitchen oil burning in a stove in the fall when the kids would come. Oh yeah, they turned on the kitchen stove to heat the house. Can you imagine? That would have been about 1938. Marblehead had changed a lot in my lifetime, a whole lot. Because Bob Newman and I were talking about Clifton. When we were growing up, Don, Clifton was not developed. But you got all these to help them develop. So West Shore Drive was open. Now, open? You can't think of it. But it was altogether different. And how important it is to remember this, because Bob did a great article for Dennis Curtin's book on the pathways. He grew up in Clifton. His memories of Clifton are priceless because he grew up there. Everybody knows about Marblehead downtown, for heaven's sake. It's in every history book printed. But what about Clifton? What was it like? Keep your pictures. Keep them marked. Remember things that happened in school. Remember a married school teacher? Never. It was Miss So-and-so, and never a man. You didn't get male teachers until you got to junior high school. And then was that fun. Because remember I said nobody mixed? We sized up those girls from Glover's little school. Because the rest of us downtown were fairly poor. But the Clifton area got a lot of people whose parents worked at the General Electric. So they had some bucks. So they had kind of nice clothes. The rest of us did what we could, you know. Going to school, remember cursive writing? They don't even teach that anymore. They're coming back, I get it. But cursive, I spent all those hours doing circles and push-pulls. Remember that? Keep it in your head when you're thinking of what you're going to talk about. Because the stuff in your youth, you thought, what the heck? But no, it's important. It really is. Nowadays, everybody's in everybody else's face. Some of the things that are said on computers these days, if you ever said that to somebody, you would have a mouthful of knuckles. No, they can get away with it. I hate it. I prize privacy. Believe it or not. I do. I think I've all loved living in Marblehead. I have absolutely loved it. You could go just about anywhere with impunity. And also, remember something else? Curfew. They used to ring curfew at 9 o'clock. Jack and I were dating. I was sitting on my mother's front porch. And he turned to me and he said, "Buddy, did that clock just ring 24? I said, "What clock?" "Oh, of course, Abbott Hall was ringing curfew." What fun. A memory for me. The Bicentennial, there was a concert down at Cocker Park. Orchestra, beautiful. They were playing the 1812 Overture. Guess who was ringing the bell in Abbott Hall? My brother was a building inspector. And as long as you got the thing moving, you could keep it moving, of course you'd pick it right up off the ground. But I was reading the other da 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 bomb. That was great fun. Things like that. So remember the years before, after a while, they didn't put the Crocker Park float out? They quit. But what's his name? Coffin had it put back. And it's a great place to swim if you swim. Believe it or not, I never learned. I don't swim. Water is for ducks and for fish. It's not for me. know that some of the people in this room go back to the very first settlers. One of them being Donald Oliver. To think that they're still living in the town. It's remarkable. And if I look at somebody, I thought I would never do this in my whole life. But somebody walked by the Lee Mansion door one day, and I was standing there, and I said, are you a Reynolds? Because Marblehead can tell the family tree by looking at you. That's how I know who you were. When I thought, oh, I know who that is. But you know people by their looks. And I can remember another thing about growing up in Marblehead, you couldn't get away with a thing. No, and one thing. Because my mother never went out. She didn't drive a car, she was a homebody. And yet she would say, what were you doing down on Waldron Street? I didn't even know she knew where Waldron Street was. But I was visiting a girlfriend, but she knew. She knew. And you knew who was, oh, that's that so-and-so kid. Keep an eye on him. It's fun. I love it. It's because it's like a big family. And yet you do have your privacy. Not like now, where everybody knows where you're going, what you're doing, and when you're going to do it, and how come you're not here now. I don't want that. I don't want that. But keep your pictures. Mark who you are, who they are, when it was taken, because it means a lot for the archives. We've got some wonderful photographs, but, and some of them we don't even know, we're not sure they're even Marblehead. Fred Lichman did get around a whole lot. So, please. Mark things and enjoy. Just remember how wonderful it is to live here. Really. I loved every second of it. If you have any questions about anything, I'll try to answer. Yes, ma'am.
Billy, my Atkins family came from Stacy Coy, of course. And they used to call it Chinatown, right?
Well, yeah.
And why?
Well, there were little shops in there. Not shut. There was, Johnny Goodwin had a building in that area, and in it he made parts for shoe manufacturing facilities, okay? And at one point, the shoe manufacturing people went out on strike, and the people who owned the factory said, oh, the heck with you, we'll hire Chinese help. And they did it for what they call coolie wages, okay? They didn't get paid what the workers in the shoe factories were getting paid. And so the story is that it was called Chinatown because all the guys, well, they think we're working for coolie wages down here. So that's how it got the name Chinatown. But Johnny Goodwin had a, it's where the Bartlett's Garage is.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because no one knew what I was talking about.
No, there were no Chinese there. Yeah. It was just because of the factory strike and that the factory people hired Chinese laborers.
Yeah.
So,
and I asked Carolyn Samelchuk one time,
yeah,
and she about said the same thing.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, that's it. It's fun to think about what was in town. I did an oral history with a fellow from Stacy Court, and he talked about there was a piggery in there.
Oh.
Now, can you imagine a piggery in Stacy Court? But people, face it, Marblehead smelled terrible. Way back in the 17th century, we started smelling when we first started drying fish, because it wasn't a classy place to live. You know, I mean, Jeremiah and Martha Lee smelled fish drying. It probably smelled like money, but it was smelly. The streets were messy, etc. But I can remember when they used to plow the sidewalks.
Yeah.
Can you imagine going to school? You walk on a plowed sidewalk. How exciting. They don't do that anymore. They don't do that anymore. Also, remember police boxes? They're disappearing everywhere. The police officers on a beat would have to stop at a box and call in so that the officers back in the station would know that they're on the beat. Also, fire boxes. They're becoming something of the past. So all of a sudden, when I was a kid, they used to deliver mail twice a day.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And during Christmas, they would deliver it as it came in.
Yeah.
You see, those kids would deliver it. They were youngsters that were hired, you know, teenagers. But imagine the luxuries we had and we didn't know. And it's a great, as I say, it was great to live. But all of those memories, prod yourself, remember, what was it like to go to school in a snowstorm? What did you wear to school in a snowstorm? They don't wear much now, but we used to wear ski pants and all that good stuff. I never will understand flip-flops, by the way. In the middle of winter, there'll be somebody in a parking lot going through this ice on the puddles, and they're going through it flip-flops. Okay, whatever. One of the things that I have saved, my husband insisted, the blizzard of 78 in photographs. That's pretty interesting. I participated briefly yesterday with a woman from Salem Sound. They're talking about Marblehead Harbor in the years. And I brought photographs, well, brought the Marblehead reporter, with water hitting the houses along Front Street, the glass two. Picture Front Street for a second. You're heading down to the fort. On the left, there's Adams House Apartments. Used to be a restaurant when I was a kid. Adams House Apartments, and then there's this black building, shiny black. When I was a kid, that was a souvenir stand on pilings. It evolved and morphed into what you've got now. One storm, Jack took his little TV camera, and we went over to Front Street when it was a bad water coming in, one fun to do. And my father's truck, my father's a contractor, was packed up in front of that building. And I said, going on. My brother, one of my brothers came out the door. He said, you want to take some shots? Go in the house. So Jack went in the house. He took some photographs. He was showing them to me on the television when we got home. Everything with water pouring in the harbor was all of a sudden the screen goes black. I said, what the hell happened? He was on the third floor in that building and the water broke in through the window. That's why my brother was there boarding up the building. You want to live right on the water? Not me. Okay, I'm all fine.
You good? Any questions?
Any other questions about anything? Please. Oh, identify stuff.
Good timing.
I thought so.
Yes. As usual.
She's
used to it.
All right,
let's see who is next.
I'm supposed to be out here.
Yeah.
No.
Can I make a comment on that last? I was in that very same house during a hurricane with my friend Steve, and we were helping the people move stuff out when I watched green water rise up over the window, just solid green water. And I said to my friend, let's get out of here, and we started to run for the front door. And just as we did that, the entire front of that building caved in.
Oh, jeez. That's scary. My goodness. All right, sorry. So who is next? Helen, are you still interested? You interested in talking?
Yes.
Good, come on up. I feel like saying you're the next contestant.
All right,
you're good to go.
I'm gonna talk about Uptown. My family came from Stacy Coy. My name is Helen Atkins Mace, and my grandfather, Kaiser Atkins, was the fire chief in the early 30s. But I was born in the house number 1 Essex Street, up over Chet's video.
Yes.
And downstairs was Harris's Bakery. And on the other side, Hardy Snow, and he was on the fire department, and his family lived. And downstairs was Marty Burke's barbershop. To the right of 1 Essex Street, we had the Marblehead Diner. We started to go down Essex Street, and we had the Lynn Gas and Electric, and the, there was a club up above on the second floor. And right across from Harris's Bakery, in Tony's building, was the Unity Service. And as you went up Spring Street, on Spring Street, upstairs was the VFW. And I used to go there every Saturday. My mother was in the auxiliary, and she'd give me a bank book, and she'd put a couple bucks in the bank. And of course downstairs, next came Rogers's ice cream. Then came Mr. Tangway's shoe repair. And his daughter, Rita, ended up marrying Eddie Creighton, who was also a fire chief. And then across, of course, was the was Central Fire Station. And to the right of the fire station was Murphy's Hardware. And up above, if I remember correctly, through the school, we used to go and Dr. Williams, the dentist, would check our teeth. I think it was like 25 cents a week or something like that. And then, of course, to the left of the fire station was Mike Grady's. I think it was the Checker Lounge. Bloods was there, and Don could tell you what year it all burned down beside the fire station. And when I was a kid, on the 4th of July, they closed Spring Street. And they had entertainment, and they had music, and we all danced in the street there. And of course, I went to the store. Well, I don't know what the story was. I never asked my mother and father. I lived at Essex Street, Prospect Street, corner of Washington and Hawk Street, and then back down to Walk. I don't know if they couldn't afford to pay the rent, and we moved around, but that's where I was brought up. So I lived in that. Abby Mays was at the corner of Washington and Atlantic Avenue, 1 Atlantic Avenue. Beside her was the Lamo's shoe repair store. And then I kind of think there was something in between, but next came Brown's Bakery. And then the gas station, which eventually became Cashy's. And just beyond the gas station was, the little lunch store. Breakfast and lunch. And, of course, two more gas stations on the left. And then Woodfin's, the movers. And I went downtown a lot, down to the Spinnaker or the Clipper, and Buddy Prescott's, where we bought the dungarees for the girls. Which kind of was a no, but we did. They were tight. and down around Stacy Court, I was down there a lot. And I went to the Roland Street School with Miss Hammond, and then I went to the Story Grammar School, and of course during World War II we had the air raids, and we had to get out of the school and we go to the post office and get down below. And I just have wonderful, wonderful memories. When I graduated from Marblehead High in 1951, I worked on the avenue at Corinthian Real Estate. As you came around by the bank, there was a little, I think it was called the Red Shutters. It was a cafe. And then, of course, Eaton's Drugstore on the corner. And then, I don't know, Chez Jimon later on. And but we were, Corinthian Real Estate was in the building where the children's store is today. You had to walk up, and Bruce Hamlin was on one side. I was the secretary with Corinthian Real Estate on the other side. And then came Kniff's. And then came, we called it Shoes. We didn't call it Shoebies, we called it Shoes. Oh, but Colbert's Liquor was in between, and then Chew. And across the street was the Corinthian Fruit Market that the Pajukas ran. And the Atlantic Restaurant. And then when that went out, Bruce Hamlin moved across the street. I think Nikki Freeman might have had a store like
it's not a Goodell's.
Yeah, yes. And we were still Corinthian Real Estate. But then Bruce Hamlin was across the street, and Corinthian Real Estate moved across the street, and we were on the corner of Commercial and Washington. The school, as Betty said, and we walked to school no matter what the weather was. And we came home for lunch. We came home for lunch, remember, Patty? Yeah, we came home for lunch. And, but I have such all over town, downtown. And Bruce, Mr. Willard was talking about the boating and our, race week. And the young people would come and they would all bunk down at Crocker Park and they'd be looking for crew. And if you were, you know, even if you didn't know that much about a boat, you went on with a crew. We had such good fun. Yeah, and we were all in the same boat. None of us had too much. And Clifton, I had friends that naturally in my class of 51, Clifton. And of course, Dr. George McDonald was the president of my class. And Louie Hettinger played football, and Donnie Snow, and Palmer, and oh, I could go on forever. But I have wonderful, wonderful memories of Marblehead.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Questions for Helen? Anybody? Or something that she mentioned that made you think of something? Okay, cool. That was wonderful. Thank you. I'm just gonna, let's see who's next. We had some people that weren't sure. Karin, Rhodes,
no,
you up
yes.
for it? No? Okay, no problem. Marge?
Yeah, I'll go on.
All right, great. Come on over.
I'll represent the next generation.
Here we go.
She
I don't have anything prepared, so I'm
you're
just going to
no,
talk
you're
off the cuff.
Let
so,
me just,
adjust this way.
I grew up in the 50s and 60s and graduated in 72, so we'll talk about that era. And it was pretty much the same. We were segregated from, I grew up on, first 5 years were on 22 Orange Street, which was an apartment house. And actually I got to go in it this summer again. I met the woman who owns it and she said, come on in. And my mother ran Bardo's dress shop down there. And she has actually found a card that said Bardo's on it because my mother smocked dresses and I was in smocked dresses till I was 40, I think. Then we moved up to Peach Highlands, which at that time was a new house that my mother had built by herself. Well, she had built it by herself, but she was a single mother. And so again, we were like the rest of the town. We didn't have too much. And I hated the people that would say, oh, you're from Marblehead, you're so rich. And it would be like, I am? I didn't think so. So I went, my first memory is going to the Tiny Tot Nursery School on Elm Street, run by Mrs. Gorman. And all I remember really is the roller coaster that was in there. There was this wooden roller coaster that you get to ride up and down on. It was cool. And they had a swing set there. And I remember when we moved from Orange Street to Peach Highlands, they had a little, I think it was a little bus or something that brought us home. They forgot to drop me off because they didn't know I moved. So I ended back up at the school. So I attended the Gary School, and I had Miss Powers, who happened to be a friend of my grandmother's. So she was always at my house playing cards. And Mrs. Houghton, Mrs. Waller, Miss Finch, who was another friend of my grandmother's. Of course, my mother had all these as teachers too, so it was like, oh, I had your mother. You know. Mrs. Rocket and Mrs. Kent. And I just remember it was so much fun then. I mean, you went to school, couldn't wear pants, so we, you know, had our dresses on, we'd go to school, and we'd have to come home and change and get right back out and play. It was like back to the schoolyard we went. We had baseball games where we'd try and hit it at Gary School. There was the banking with the wall. If you got it over the wall, it was a home run. Broke a window. Well, that was an extra bonus. And we used to slide down the hill in the winter. It just seems like we were outside playing all the time in your own little neighborhood. So you could just walk around all day. You'd come home at 5 o'clock when the whistle blew and have your dinner. And if it was summer, you'd go back out again. And you'd stay out till it was the street lights came on and you'd come home. I used to, the Gary School, we used to try and climb up on, there was a little shed thing out back. We'd climb up on that. We'd try and walk around the ledge of the building. You know, nobody was watching us. We just thought this was fun. There was just, I guess, just so much freedom. And you stayed in your own little area. Summers, we just spent, you know, at the beach. You just go off for the day. It was just be like, we had park league, what was called park league in the summer. And each park in town, I went to the one, of course, at Green Street. I guess it's Reynolds Playground now. But, and they have activities for you. We used to do gimp and kickball. But you know what?
Yeah.
We never had to take a bottle of water with us. Everybody has to have a bottle of water. It's like, we'd be there all day long with no water, except for the rusty bubbler that was down there. What else did we do? Well, I know, like, when we got a little bit older, well, again, we were separated. I didn't know what Clifton, don't ride your bike past Kent's Corner, I was always told. Okay, I won't. Well, I did, but it was like, why can't I go past Kent's Corner? Like, I was told not to. Let's see, what else?
Why?
Oh, I remember talking about, Betty was talking about walking to school. Well, back in when I was in junior high, I had to walk. There was no bus. I walked 2 miles every day in the snow. And at that time, we had mini skirts and knee socks. And by the time you got to school, walking from Peach Islands up Village Street, which was as cold could be, your legs were absolutely purple for the day. You were like, freeze, because that was it. You couldn't wear pants to school. I think my senior year, we finally got to wear pants to school. And in the grammar schools, it was so funny. They'd have Miss Blankhorn would come around and teach us our exercises. And the girls had to go in the back of the room because we had our dresses on. And we were going to, you know, do our bend and stretch and everything. And we didn't want the little boys to see our underwear, I guess. So it was like we had to do that. I don't know. I just remember that. It was just a great place. And even growing up as a teenager, you just went, you were out all the time. You know, you didn't get into much trouble. You'd go down the wharf and go fishing and get some clam bellies or whatever it was for bait at McLean's and drop your thing and bring up some flounders. And that was the fun for the whole day. Or you'd go to the driftwood and get some onion rings and hot chocolate. I remember that was always a great thing to do. So. I don't know, I just really enjoyed Marblehead, and I don't live here now, I live in Raleigh, but my father still lives here, and I was thinking, I've been saying, I don't want to come back to Marblehead, but as I was driving through town today, I said, you know what, I think I do want to come back. So, that's my story growing up.
Let me run downstairs and see if we had some latecomers. Oh, Francie, go ahead.
Question.
Downtown, you went to the Old One Church or something like that. And we had so much people that came into town.
Yeah.
And
we
weren't supposed
yeah.
to go out see them. I didn't know what a Jewish person was. I didn't know what a black person was until I got to junior high.
Oh, we did.
Black people down in Stacy Court.
It was like,
really?
England?
I have to speak up for Clifton.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much. Okay, so good. Karen's changed her mind, so we're super happy about that. So Karin Rhodes, everybody.
Go for it.
Tense Corner. Roden Road.
Yeah.
Born 53, Mary Alley.
Yeah.
The new Mary Alley. Graduated in 71, so I remember the freezing legs.
You remember?
Going, oh. Okay, so I grew up on Broughton Road until I was 15 years old. I now live across the street. We only had to carry our stuff across the street, and I still live in the family house. My brother still lives in town. My name is Rhodes. My brother was Ben, who owned the sub shop. And yeah, Rhodes is a Rhodes is a Rhodes in this town. My father had the spelling change back after Samuel messed it all up. You know, my father's birth certificate said one thing, his stuff in the army said another thing. So we're back to the old English spelling, but we're all the same family. And okay, so growing up on Broughton Road, my big memory of loving Marblehead so much is I grew up in Sarosa's farm. I grew up on Seven Rivers property. I slept on Broughton Road, but out of the house all the time. 6 in the morning on Saturday morning, we'd be out of the house, me and Lynette Cash, Phil Cash's daughter, Philip's sister. And my father, being a cheap Yankee, growing up in the Depression and living on Broughton Road, took nails out of everything that he would be taking apart. You have an old door somewhere. Yeah, pull the nails out. You can use them again. I had a bucket of nails and my own hammer from the time I was about 8 years old. And Lynette and I, with our saw, we were out there building things, playing in those castles. Oh my gosh, those castles were so wonderful. And I never did thank the Sevenor brothers for leaving 3 piles of 2x4s in the woods out behind the house that was the schoolhouse, the school administration building.
Yeah.
They had put piles of wood out there from their hardware store, and they weren't using it. And it was just sitting there. Oh, and it was very tempting to all of us. So we learned how to build a frame house ourselves. Lynette and I could put in hinges. We had trap doors on our. We built the best forts, and we fought World War II all over the fields with my buffalo rifle. And yeah, there were the pear trees, and we'd go out at, like I said, 6 in the morning. Don't make any noise until 7 or 8. You know, no hammers yet. But yeah, stay out all day, no water. I didn't go to the bathroom in the bushes. I don't remember going home either. But it would just be go out and, but don't eat those pears, all the Bartlett pears that were still there from the farm. You'd chew them and spit it out, but we would use them like hand grenades. Boy, it could hurt you. And the grapes, oh, I was heartbroken when they built the high school, because now I didn't have any place for grapes. And you mentioned your relative Jerry that I went to high school with. In high school, the grapes were still there, and my father used to make homebrew until the bottles started exploding, and my mother said, we can't have you going down in the cellar and having your son picking you up a homemade beer for things are going to explode, so no more. But we still had the crock, so Jerry and I picked a pile of grapes, and I have a picture of us stamping the grapes and eating grapes. I'm like a sophomore in high school. My father took the picture of me, so you know this is all, my parents knew this. And they let me like not blow things up, but let's have some real live homemade grape juice. And yeah, that made it to my high school senior party and was passed around under the table. The tree houses, my love of nature. There were the polywog ponds. And yeah, we were told as little kids you couldn't go past, like right where the road is to the high school now. The road would go down to the. Yeah, you probably remember the old soccer field before the high school was actually built on that land. There was this soccer fields down the back. We could not go past that road, just like you couldn't go past Ken's Corner, because our mothers couldn't yell far enough. The big kids, the boys, could go across. So that was exotic land where there was an apple tree and that semicircular castle. I still don't even know what some of those buildings were at Sarosa's farm, but there was a semicircular thing that we dared each other. You had to walk around it because, you know, it was high. It was like as high as where the roof's bends here. What would you call that? As tall as this room is without the roof on it. To walk around that, just the stone's about 2 feet wide or so, and not fall off, especially when it was covered with poison ivy and you had to step special so we didn't get that. So that was a rite of passage to walk around that. And they were just wonderful. All the castles, there was a like triple level cap castle that, again, I don't know what it was, maybe horses or something in there, where the blackberries grew, the black raspberries. Oh, you could just stay there all day. Well, that's what I ate, I guess. But what all else was there? And that beautiful, gorgeous chicken coop. I know somewhere there is a photograph of that with the winding stairways to it. And it was multiple levels. And we were just playing in the ruins of the castles. And nobody was ever telling us that, watching over us and telling us that we had to be in these organized sports. And you make it up yourself. So there, just wanted to give the plug for Clifton. Sarosa's Farms. And how I learned to love nature and build things. Yes.
Can you tell me what you meant by the castles?
Yeah.
Sarosa's Farms was, when was it, in the 19th century? It was in Lynn, he was a shoe manufacturer. I don't remember his name, but he built this farm because it was all part of this idealistic.
It was a farm, yeah. It was a farm with a barn for cows, and they had big silos. I also grew up on Broken Road. I just don't remember. Moynihan.
Oh, okay. I graduated with Lois.
My sister.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was
number 8.
We called them the castle. Oh yeah, we were down 50.
Yeah.
Yeah. Way down the circle.
Because they were stone foundations of these buildings. It was these marvelous state of the art farm that was all about factory workers could go out there and get fresh food, and he had like prize winning cattle, and it was like really top of the line. Fancy stuff.
It was to supply food and eggs for the workers of the shoe factory that he owned in Lynn.
Oh.
Yeah.
And this was established so that they could have fresh fruits and vegetables eggs and chickens and things like that.
I think the castles were really the architecture of the farm. And they were amazing fieldstone and shingle buildings.
There's one still there. It's right behind the community center, right behind the bocce field in the back.
Oh, yeah.
That was my backyard, because I was right in the second house.
Back.
And that was right, that was the wall of our house.
Yeah, when we were kids, I grew up around in Clifton further down.
Yep.
But we used to go up the railway tracks and then penetrate the woods.
Yeah.
We had no idea about Sarosa's Farms. And we discovered all these ruins in the woods there, and we decided they were Aztec ruins.
Yeah!
We used to call them the Aztec ruins.
We thought they were from the Middle Ages.
Oh.
We thought we were in France or something.
Yeah.
But what it did to the imaginations. But you were right down there with the polywog ponds.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the ice skating. Yeah, So that, yeah, we weren't allowed beyond the railroad tracks.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you had for the limit.
We could go to Blueberry Hill, but over the
okay.
hill was they just
okay.
built the Jewish Community Center, and we would pick blueberries while we watched everybody in the pool. They had a nice pool there. We had never seen a built-in pool before, so we'd sit up and eat our berries and watch them all people go into the pools. But you couldn't go beyond that, yeah, because it went all the way to Atlantic Ave in those days. There was nothing there.
Yeah,
Elizabeth
yeah, yeah.
Road and all those streets weren't in.
Yeah.
Nothing was in.
It's like
yeah.
exotic. Yeah, we were another world. We were. Yeah, that's why don't go mixing there. You don't
yeah.
know what kind of people are out there. Like we're a bunch of cannibals. Or something. That was wild. It was, there's that absolute limit of Clifton, and I always felt bad because I wanted to live in Barnegat. You know, I didn't feel like a real Marbleheader growing
yeah.
up there.
I always wanted to go to the Star of the Sea school because they had such nice little outfits.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
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 And talk about the Star of the Sea. My children went there, and the nuns always thought that we were rich here in Marblehead. And I used to say, sister, I grew up in Marblehead when we had outhouses, and we had no hot water. We had to heat it for our baths. Same at Salem Hospital. When I worked there, they thought, oh, you were rich coming from Marblehead. Little did they know.
I did go to Star of the Sea with Helen's kids. I met my husband in kindergarten at Star of the Sea. But walking to school when it was cold, we had to wear uniforms. And my mother always hemmed the uniforms with that iron-on stuff, which froze
stiff.
Like plastic. So by the time we got to school, and he would drive by with his family and wave to my sister. But we were bleeding by the time. They were in purple. We were bleeding because of that plastic stuff my mother did the uniform. Oh, I remember walking to Star of the Sea.
And the kids walk.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
From Jersey Street.
Oh, yeah. And the one other thing that I was remembering about the cold, walking to school in the cold, don't you remember when it was snowing and you sat there quietly waiting to hear
yes.
the fire,
yeah.
the
yes.
fire horn?
Yeah.
Just, you know, with the fire department would blow the horn
yeah.
and it's like, yes!
And I could always hear the fog horn, so if I heard that, I said, must be a storm. Maybe we'll get the fire whistle next and we won't have to go to school.
No school?
No school, yeah, because they didn't have the automatic phone
yeah.
thing or
on
the internet.
WESX used to tell us.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah,
yeah,
I don't think my mother had a radio.
I'm so glad. We do have two more people signed up. Is it Mr. Erbette?
Yes.
Come on up.
Okay, I had a different experience, Marblehead experience. So I ended up here as a kid. I think I was 5 or 6 years old, so that would have been 48, 49. And I was actually brought, I brought my prop. This reminds me of my grandfather because he was the one who brought me to Marblehead because he used to rent a camp, Usher's Camp. I don't know whether.
Oh,
okay,
on the beach.
I'm sure you
on
remember, right on the beach, yeah. All the way from Somerville.
Yeah.
Okay. And he always used to come up, and my brother and sister and I had 1 week with my grandfather at one of the camps. And it was a camp. I don't
what
know whether
sure
you were
was.
Inside yet. It was really roughing it. But my grandfather used to make his own net. He was an old Italian fisherman. And I always wondered, why did he come to Marblehead? So fast forward to 1969, and I was in the Navy, and I was assigned to Naples, and I ended up going to Gaeta, which is where he fished as a kid before he came to America. And I'm on the beach at in Gaeta, and it was almost an exact replica Marblehead. So Marblehead used to remind him of his town, Gaeta, had the beach. Behind the beach was the harbor. You go through, if you've been to Gaeta, it's a beautiful seaport town. It was also the home of Sixth Fleet, and it had an Italian Navy base there. But anyway, so it was 1969 when I got there, and I said, no wonder why Pa, you know, came up to Marblehead, because it was almost like being in Gaeta with the beach and the town in behind. So my experience was in the late 40s, early 50s. So I can tell you, and we lived, my family came from Woburn, but we had at least 1 week, if we were lucky we'd get 2 weeks at the camps. My grandmother, when she was alive, she was very religious. And I remember we used to walk from the ushers to Star of the Sea for Mass, in the daily Mass. And she would sit me on the left side. There was Our Lady of Star of the Sea was holding a boat. And she used to say, now you pay attention to the lady, she's holding a boat. And so I would be like this. Anyway, the other thing I remember, the Barnacle, and some of the Barnacle was wide open at the time. There were no windows, no screens, and Mrs. Brown used to own the Barnacle, and she used to sit behind the counter, and she had. She always was smoking, and the cigarette, the ash on her cigarette would be about an inch or 2 inches long, and of course the cook staff would be bringing chowder out in front and setting it in front of Mrs. Brown, and of course the ashes, when the wind came in, blew the ashes all over the chowder. And I think to this day, that's what made the chowder stuff. Mrs. Brown's ashes that flew into the chowder. So later on, my father bought a house on Edgemere. So we were talking about neighborhoods. We weren't even allowed to leave Nargis Head in Edgemere, that area.
Yeah.
Except I had a bike, and I used to scoot down to the water, to the harbor. There were a couple of things. Not too many people know, you probably knew, there was a pony farm down on the left side of State Street.
Phil Woodford.
Phil Woodford.
Yeah. And there was, evidently there was a cow, there was a stable plus cows, they used to milk cows down there. So anyway, I had two girlfriends, Susie and Susan, used to take the ponies out and give pony rides to the kids. And sometimes, if we were lucky, they would take the ponies up to Nargis Head, and we had free pony rides up in Nargis Head. So, but it was a great place to grow up, even in summers. My father, when he the shack that we lived in, it was a shack on the water though, on Edgemere. We tore it down and we built a fairly modern house. And he was looking at the assessments in Marblehead. The downtown Marblehead, and if you're in real estate, the assessments were so low, and they were kept low, so you'd pay the lower taxes. And so the new people that moved in the Clifton areas and so forth, were paying most of the taxes because the old Yankees they were paying $100, $200 for taxes and so forth. And so they kept, my father was very upset. He said, you know, these people aren't keeping their houses up. And some of them were legitimately, you know, they were fishermen and lobstermen. So they, you know, they had a tough time keeping the houses up. But the place to live when I was a kid wasn't downtown, because that was pretty run down. Well, you know, relatively speaking. But was outside of the downtown area and also the uptown area. That was actually pretty good. If you could live beyond where Star of the Sea was, that was, and of course the Neck. The Neck was you know, if we were lucky and we had cars, we could scoot around the Neck and see all of the real rich people. But anyway, it was a fun place to grow up. I learned history. I joined the Navy, came back to Marblehead, and it gave me a sense of actually to appreciate this place. And of course, I joined the regiment in 74 when we reconstituted the regiment, and I'm still a member, if you can believe. So those are my thoughts. There was one, I wasn't a very good student, and I used to have to go to summer school. There was an old school, and maybe you could remember this, it was on the street between Pleasant and Washington. It was way up on a hill. It looked like a little cape. And supposedly, and there was a plaque on there when I was a kid, because my tutor was in there, and it was up on a hill. In fact, I was going to ask some of the town historians. I'll have to ask Don Dolliver, maybe he remembers. But it was a schoolhouse too, because they were old. She used to set me down in a table, a bench, but there were chairs and old desks that you probably remember in
the
Gary school. They were all up there, but I could never find out. Now it's a house. Somebody took the thing over and made a house out of it. But I was going to ask. Oh, you remember that? What was it?
Rockaway.
That's
Street.
It. That's the street.
And on the hill was
a
schoolhouse that Joseph Story started teaching in before he went into the law.
There you go. That's
and
it.
That was where Rockaway was the Methodist Steps. There were rocks that had been blown out, hence the term Rockaway.
That's why we have historians to know that sort of stuff. No, thank you for that. But I remember having to bike from Naugus Head over to Rockaway, climb all of those steps, and pull my bike up so no one would take it up the steps and dump it there. But anyway, so that was some of the things we did in the summers. I remember the train coming in, where Starbucks, we used to have the circus coming to town. I don't know whether you remember that. That was always a fun thing. We used to look forward to that. And then also the musters.
The
field.
Okay. And the great race.
The great race. That was what. But if you look at the, if you go to Reynolds now, they cut the all the trees down up to the where the dog park is now. So as a kid, I remember going to the muster and so forth, and all of the old teenagers were sitting up on the ledge up there drinking beer and throwing beer cans down. Anyway, but seeing it all cut down and exposed reminded me of what it was as a kid during the musters and seeing these teenagers drink up there. Anyway, I could go on and on if I just get queued up. But anyway, any questions? Mostly in the 50s, I was away most of the '60s and '70s in the Navy. Every once in a while, I did come back. Yes, sir.
Well, when was the regiment started?
Regiment, the reconstituting,
yeah, right.
Yeah, was 1974.
Okay.
Yeah, Buddy Butler. I'm trying to think the original. Some of them have passed away. Buddy is still in. He's in Salem now, but he put together a group, and I happened to see it in the reporter. Saying, you know, we're come down to the old townhouse and sign up. And so, in fact, there was a Rhodes there who signed, one of the Rhodes, I don't know where. Anyway, there's, yeah, it was one of the Rhodes was there. He was a member. So I was like the fifth member. We're all standing getting our enlistment sign aboard. And behind me was Fred Bauer, okay, the drummer. I guess I was the token Italian because we didn't have one. but yeah, that was a great, I still have, I actually still have my same uniform that I started with. It's a little torn, but I still wear it. But that was great fun. We traveled all over during the 76. People used to send us, I mean, we had a full schedule from 75 all the way through 77, 78. And the regiment actually went to most of the places that the original regiment, we actually fought the battle down in Pell's Point. We evacuated some people from Brooklyn Heights in a boat across the East River, which is a lot of fun. And people, you know, paid us to put this on during the bicentennial because we were the most original and we were the actual representation of the original regiment that left here in 75 to go to meet up with General Washington. So, yeah, it was a great experience. And let me tell you, that was the best history lesson I ever got because you lived it. Yes, ma'am.
Tonight is the regiment's march.
Yes,
to burial
the memorial march. Thank you.
So, yeah. You are interested in going 5 o'clock at the old townhouse?
Yeah, we're leaving at 5.
Yes.
And proceed up to Burial Hill. I remember the first couple of times we did it with actual torches, lit off torches.
Yeah.
And when it was windy, you'd see, I thought we were gonna see Marblehead go up in smoke, but the flames and everything. We'd go down Washington Street and you could see.
Yeah.
And you know, now that I think of it, it's amazing we didn't, of course we had the firehouse down. but anyway, that was pretty interesting. And as I said, we did the whole.
January.
In January,
yeah.
He died.
Yeah.
General Glover died, coincidentally, on 30 January, which just happens to be my birthday. Yeah, so anyway, so it's easy to remember when he died, as long as I stay alive. Anyway, any other questions? Comments? Okay, thank you.
And last but not least, Richard Bowen. All set.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good morning. Some of you, you hear the old stories, the old town and all that, you might know where Bowen's Corner is. Anybody know where Bowen's Corner is? You know who Judge Nathan Bowen was? Okay, well, that Bowen House is behind the old townhouse at the corner of Mugford Street. So Nathan Bowen, Ashley Bowen, the Journals of Ashley Bowen. Nathan Bowen was the tutor to Joseph Story, who, of course, was the youngest Supreme Court Justice, and later was the dean of a new school in Cambridge called Harvard Law School. So I like to tell that story, and then people will say, so that was your family? And I say, well, what do you think? No, it wasn't my family. Name is Bowen. My family came in 1948. My grandfather was a first generation Irish Catholic, went to Holy Cross and Harvard Law School, so there's a connection there. We like to say he was the first Irish Catholic to go to Harvard Law School. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's a Marblehead story, right? You make it up. My father and mother moved here in 1948 when I was born. I graduated from high school in 1966. I had a brother in 60, a sister in 62, a brother in 64.
Is that Tom?
Tom's my brother.
My classmate.
My brother Fred was class of 71. Ben Rhodes was the first baseman on my Little League team, the Dodgers. So we were part of, I think, a bridge in Marblehead where the educated Catholics came into town, mostly Irish and Italian, and educated Jewish families came into town. So I really think it's an important time that the town should understand. A real change started happening then. We grew up on Lester Road, and I remember fighting with Betty Brown for years. It's Lester Road, not Leicester Road.
Not Leicester.
Okay. So our house was the last house on the street. There was nothing from there to until you hit Atlantic Avenue, as people have talked about what it was like in town around that time. They moved in January of 48. I was born in October of 48. My mother had already had three children and did not go downtown until May of that year. Talk about being in a neighborhood. It was, you were sort of isolated. But that neighborhood had its own post office, if you remember.
Yeah.
Clifton had a post office. The original Brown's Bakery was in Clifton. There was a gas station, and there was a gift shop that Errol Beach was the principal of the school,
yeah,
of the high school. His wife ran the little gift shop there.
Yeah.
All this stuff is, you know, falling behind in the waves or whatever. But
Beach. Mrs. Beach.
Mrs. Beach?
Yeah. Errol Beach was
Errol Beach
principal.
Is
it?
Yeah.
He was the principal.
And we all went to Star of the Sea School. And one of the things that happened when all these educated Catholics came in is they built a school. So that was a pretty big contribution to the town, changed it, and we were all educated there. I have pictures of First Communion, which is, in white suits and, all the processions and the whole bit. And I would say there was, I've gathered some family stories. My daughter, who lives in town and has three kids of her own and married somebody from town, urge to sort of gather family stories, and it's been a great exercise. Growing up, we were attacked. We'd go out the door and play. You'd have this sort of net. You couldn't go beyond a certain point. It was my mother could trill, which is it's somewhere between calling and whistling, but it's unique, but you'd hear it and you'd just come home. But you'd go out in the start of the day and you'd be gone until you heard the trill and until the street lights came on or whatever. We went to Preston Beach, so we grew up on Preston Beach, which, depending upon where you grew up, was the determinant of a lot of that stuff. When I say we were also sort of the bridge, our group, I'd say, with the other parts of town. Because in the 1950s, as some of you guys remember, Little League Baseball was started. So we played Little League Baseball, and I became friends with, of course, the Braves were all Clem Rogers, Dave Rogers, the Sumners. It was all downtown kids, okay? But you got to know them, and you played with them. And we're all friends today. We, when we were in grade school, we actually challenged some, like, Glover's school to a football game. And played the junior high in a football game. And it started that bridge. I remember playing basketball down at Seaside with John Ormiston, who, I don't know if you guys know Johnny. And he was saying, "No, I'm playing hockey." And I said, "But what are you playing hockey for?" You know. And of course, the Marblehead Maroons and the history of hockey. And when I was in high school, nobody went to our basketball games. They were all watching John and Tommy Livingston and Tootie Cahoon and win championships. And it was such an amazing time because I remember when the high school won a game in the Garden, and of course John Kiley, who played down at the Molly Waldo, broke out into, I think it was Dana Prince scored like 3 goals in the last minute and beat the team, and John Kiley broke into Marblehead Forever, which he was just amazing, because you probably remember when Fisk hit the home run. Does anybody remember what what Kiley broke into? Beethoven's Ode to Joy. I mean, only in Boston, right? But I haven't prepared anything, but it just any things about growing up here. I did have a couple of pictures. I looked at my 8th grade graduating class from Star of the Sea. Most of us all went to the high school, and we all integrated in with, you know, Jewish friends, Catholic friends, downtown friends. Yeah. It really did feel like the town changed then. Tom McNulty became a selectman, who was a guy who was like the first Jewish selectman. There was a lot of, just the town started to break through some barriers. My father, who was an advertising executive, he was the president of the Little League one year. He was a big believer in delegating authority, though. He also bowled at the Maple Leaf Lanes, if you remember the Maple Leaf Lanes, and had high single one year at 151. So he made an effort to kind of get in with the townies and new people from all over town. And I mean, all of us love the town and have felt it's been a privilege to grow up here. My first childhood memory, somebody said about the library. My first childhood memory is going with my father, which would be a special event to be one of 7 to say, "Hey, do you want to come with me? I'm going to the library." I went with my father to the library, and it was in Abbott Hall. And there's a Spirit of 76 in the stacks behind, you know, really. It was literally a treasure like that was hidden away. And then, of course, we have a new library, we have a new high school, we have all those things. Some things popped up when I was just listening to other people talk, too. But this is just, I can only just scratch the surface of it now. I think this is a great idea. My daughter had given me as a gift something called Storyworth. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that. It's an online thing where you get questions to answer. And it's a way of collecting family stories. So be like, what was it like? How's life different now than when you were growing up? And I'd say like by Glover's school, there was a truck farm. I don't know if any of you remember that. Wheeler's Corner, we called it.
We had a plot in that.
You had a plot? Yeah. There were no street lights in Marblehead. The only one was at Ocean Ave. I remember riding my bike home from Star of the Sea on Atlantic Avenue and seeing 2 cars the whole time I was riding home. Try that. So, okay. Well, thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah.